Biology.
Hello there and welcome to this class. We are going today around us to discuss about transport in plants and animals. So the transport in geography is totally different from the transport in biology. Whereby transport in biology says that transport is the movement of substances within an organism. So the substances must move within an organism. So the excretory products need to be transported to the sites where they will be removed off the body. Retention of these excretory products will poison the cells and in turn the whole organism might perish. Also, transport is very much important because the cells of the body require nutrients so as to be able to conduct their biological processes in an optimal manner. So, for example, the amoeba is a unicellular organism which has a very large surface area to volume ratio in terms of the environment. So, their bodies are in great contact with the environment as compared to the multicellular organism. So, due to this feature, diffusion here plays a very much important role in removing substances of amoeba or movement of substances within the amoeba itself. So, large multicellular organisms, like maybe for example we have mammals, we have reptiles, they mostly have a very much advanced or a complex structure whereby movement of substances within their bodies cannot really depend only on diffusion, because their bodies, first of all, they contain very many cells and they contain very many features. Therefore, the higher organisms must have an elaborate transport system. So, simple plants like mosses and liverworts, also they lack a specialized transport system. While higher plants, like maybe for example, we have the pine tree or trees in short, they must or they have a specialized transport system. So this specialized transport system, it's mainly the vascular bundle, which mainly comprises of the xylem and the phloem. So transportation in plants mainly happens in three levels. So first of all is the uptake of water and mineral ions, whereby this is cell for photosynthesis and respiration are mainly concerned in this uptake of water and mineral salts. So the next level is short distance transport, whereby this only involves cell to cell at level of tissue and organs. So the last one is long distance transport, whereby this is the transport of sap by the vascular bundles at only the plant level. The transport system in plants mainly consists of the vascular bundles that we had looked at. And the vascular bundle consists of the xylem, which conducts water and mineral salts throughout the plant, and the phloem, which conducts food substances throughout the plant. So the vascular tissue are mainly located on the following organs. So the first one is the root, the second one is the stem, and the third one, it's the leaf. So the function of the root is to, the primary function is to absorb water and for support. The stem conducts water from the roots to the leaves, and then the leaves, their function is to carry out photosynthesis, and again we look at transpiration. So physiological processes like osmosis, diffusion, and active transport mainly enhance the transport of materials within the plant. Like for example, we saw amoeba, it mainly uses diffusion, a physiological process for movement of substances in or out of the body. So let's begin by looking at the first plant organ, which is the root. So the root has different functions and it has the following functions. So the first one is that the root absorbs water and mineral salts from the soil. It has root hairs which assist in doing this. So also the root anchors the plant to the ground, or it provides a supporting medium for the plant. So in some plants, the root acts as a storage medium. Example, we have the cassava and also we have the carrot. Most of the tubers also. And lastly, some roots also assist in breathing. We have breathing roots, which are mainly located in some of the aquatic plants that we have. So the roots are mainly subdivided into two, whereby the first one is we have the monocot root. Mainly they have fibrous root, and we have the dicot root for, mainly they have taproot. But let's look at the difference now, the difference now between the monocot and the dicot root. So in the monocot root, the pericycle produce lateral roots, while in the dicot root we see that the pericycle give rise to the lateral roots, the coque and the vascular cambium. So in the monocot root we see that the xylem is oval and round, while in the dicot root the xylem is star-shaped and it's mainly polygonal. So in the monocot root we see that the pith
is present, while in the dicot root the pith is absent. So in the monocot root, again, we see that the xylem and the phloem are very many, or biologically we can say they are numerous, while in the dicot root, the xylem and the phloem are limited. Xylem is located at the center of the plant, while phloem surrounds the xylem, so it's very much limited. Okay, apart from that, let's look at the root hairs. So what are the root hairs? So the root hairs are extension arising from the piliferous layer of the root. So it mainly absorbs water and mineral salts from the soil. So they are also one cell thick, and as we say, the xylem and the phloem, they are also numerous. The piliferous layer, this is a very thin layer of the epidermal cells which mainly give rise to the root hair. From the piliferous layer, we now go to the cortex, whereby it has loosely packed and thin-walled parenchyma cells which mainly serve the function of storing food. After the cortex, then we have the endodermis. So the endodermis mostly have corky and endothelial cells which deposit mainly on the cross walls of the structure. So they mainly regulate water and mineral salts entering the xylem by active transport. So the pericycle is the next part, which is mainly found beneath the epidermis and gives rise to the lateral roots. Then after that, we have the vascular bundle, which consists of the xylem and the phloem, whereby you said xylem conducts water and mineral salts, while phloem conducts food substances through the plant. So let's look at the adaptations of the root hair to their function. So they have numerous mitochondria to provide energy for active transport and diffusion. So the other adaptation is that they are elongated to increase the surface area over which absorption of materials in and out or into the root hair takes place. So the next adaptation is that they have a very large subvacuole which exerts a high osmotic pressure for the absorption of substances. So the next adaptation is that they are thin-walled for faster diffusion of materials in and out of their bodies. Let's now look at the vascular bundles, whereby for now I want us to begin with the xylem. So let's look at the xylem. So xylem mainly transports water and mineral salts through the plant. So the xylem tissue is mainly made up of, we have vessels and we have tracheids, whereby these two are very much different, even though both of them serve as the xylem function. So we are going to differentiate them. The vessels, they have very many cells, while the tracheids have individual cells. So the vessels are also shorter, they have very much shorter cells, while the tracheids have very much long cells. So the vessels are more advanced than the tracheids. So the tracheids are primitive than the vessel. So in the vessels, we see that the cell lumen is very large, while in the tracheids, the cell lumen is very small or it's very tiny. So in the vessels, we also see that the cells are very broad, while in the tracheids, the cells are very narrow. So the vessels are connected end to end as the tracheids are connected laterally. So those are among the differences between the vessel and the xylem. But in every difference, we must have a similarity. So what's the similarity between the vessel and the tracheids? So we see that both of them arise from the xylem. So both of them are of the xylem. So also both of them are from dead cells. So the dead cells must mature so as to make up the xylem or the phloem. So both of them are dead cells at maturity. So both also transports water and mineral ions. So both have secondary lignified cell wall for support and to hold them in position. So both of them are in primary and the secondary xylem. So let's look at the adaptations of the xylem to their function. So the first one is that they have thick lignified walls. And lignin, we say, it mainly prevents the xylem from collapsing. It mainly serves as the supporting duct for the xylem or the supporting stand for the xylem. So also, the xylem, they do not have cross walls for continuous flow of water. So they are also narrow, they have a very narrow lumen to facilitate capillarity of water from this position to that position. They also have very broad pits to allow lateral movement of water. And also, they are made of non-living material, whereby this mostly reduces resistance of water inside the xylem tissue. Let's look at the next one, whereby we have the phloem as the next vascular bundle. So the phloem is a vascular tissue mainly made of sieve plates and sieve tube elements. So the sieve plates separate two sieve tube elements mostly. Whereby, let's now look at the differences between the sieve tubes and the sieve plates. So we are going to look at the sieve cells and the sieve tubes in another word. So the sieve cells, they are mainly made of single cells, while the sieve tubes are made of aggregation of cells or very many cells brought together. So the sieve cells are less specialized, while the sieve tubes are more specialized. So the sieve cells, they have long, narrow cell wheels with mainly the tapering end walls, while the sieve plates, they are made of short, wide cells that are transverse or oblique. They have oblique end walls. So you see that the sieve cells, they have perforated end walls, while the sieve tubes, they don't have any perforated end walls. And also we see that the sieve cells, they have companion cells, while the sieve tubes, they don't have any companion cell in them. So those are among the differences between the sieve cells and the sieve tubes. Now let's look at the similarities between these two. So both are components of the phloem, just as we saw vessels and tracheids. So both, they don't have nucleus in them. So both are sieve elements, even though they have difference. So both of them are sieve elements, and both are living cells. And like the xylem, we saw that they are made of dead cells at maturity. Well, the phloem, we see that all the cells must be living. So they are both involved also in translocation, and they both have a thin primary cell wall. And then the other one is, we can see that they have a dense granular protoplasm. And then maybe you can say they form the primary and the secondary phloem in the plant. So those are the similarities. But let's look at now the adaptations of the phloem to its function. So they have hollow tubes for food to move in from point to point. They are also made up of living cells. So they are composed of living cells. Again, they have densely packed companion cells with the mitochondria to provide enough energy for active transport of materials within the phloem or within the phloem structure. So they also have the sieve post to allow easier food movement from one side to the other. Next, let's look at the stem. So this is the part of the plant connecting the root and the leafy regions of the plant. So the stem is found or it's located between the leaves and the root. So it mainly exposes the leaf to sunlight. It mainly supports the upper parts of the plant as well. So in some plants, the stem might act as a storage organ. Example, we have the potato, and we also have the sugarcane. We have the sweet potato also. In some plants also, the stem might be used for propagation. So propagation, we mean that it might be used as a seed. So we have a seed to plant, while in some plants, we might just cut the stem and plant it. So in some plants, it may be used for propagation. And example, we have the sugarcane. We also have the cassava, which can be used, the stem can be used for propagation. So the stems, they are mainly divided into two, whereby we have a monocotyledonous stem, and we have a dicotyledonous stem. They are very much different in structure, and they are very much different in terms of maybe the function that they play. So let's look at the differences between the monocot and the dicot stem. So we see that in the monocot stem, it does not have the epidermal hairs, while in the dicot stem, it has the epidermal hair. So in the monocot stem, we see that the silica deposits over the epidermis, while in the dicot stem, there is no silica deposit. So in the monocot stem, we see that the pericycle is absent, while it is present in the dicot stem. In the monocot stem now, the pith is absent. So in the dicot stem now is where now we find the pith. It's so much opposite from the root. So in the monocot stem, we see that the endodermis is not present. It's absent. In the dicot stem, we have the endodermis. In the monocot stem, we see that the vascular bundles are numerous and well distributed inside the stem. While in the dicot stem, the vascular bundles are not that numerous. So in the monocot stem, we see that the vascular bundles are conjoined and very much close together. While in the dicot stem, the vascular bundles are conjoined, but now here they are much open in terms of space. So those are among the differences between the xylem, between the monocot and the dicot stem. But let's now look at the similarities between these two. So both have a single layer of epidermis, that's one. And they also both have a thick layer of cuticle. And then we'll also say that the hypodermis is present in both. So both of them, they have an epidermis and they have a hypodermis. So the major portion of the ground tissue in the stem, that is both of them, is the parenchyma tissue. So they also have a well-organized vascular bundle. So whereby there is a xylem, there must be a phloem. So they both have conjoined vascular bundles. Even though this one is closed, this one is open. So they have a conjoined vascular bundles. And they both have a dense granular protoplasm. Biology.